So let's discuss important objective questions of building, construction and material. The first question in front of us is the type of bond provided in brick masonry for carrying heavy load is English bond. Okay, out of the given, English bond is the one that can carry heavy loads. Okay, the next question says gypsum is a, what kind of rock the gypsum is? It is a chemically precipitated sedimentary rock. Okay. It is a chemically precipitated sedimentary rock. By geological classification, it is a sedimentary rock. And the prefix, that is chemically, means it has its formation because of the chemical action. Okay. Gypsum is a chemically precipitated sedimentary rock. Then the main function of alumina in brick earth is to impart plasticity. Okay. Alumina as a constituent of brick earth imparts plasticity to the brick. Okay. Then a mortar joint in masonry which is normal to the face of the wall is known as cross joint. Okay. It is cross joint. Then which of the following pairs give a correct combination of useful and harmful constituent respectively of a good brick earth? Okay, silica is a essential component. Okay, silica is an essential component, but alkali isn't. Therefore, good one or essential one is silica and the harmful one is alkalis. Okay, the correct answer is option B. Then, excess of alumina in brick earth makes the brick to crack and to warp on drying. Okay, cracking of the brick takes place. And warping means shaping out. For example, let's say this is the standard regular horizontal and geometrical perfect shape of brick. But if the alumina gets in excess quantity, warping means shaping out. Okay, it may have some curvature or kind of shape out because of excess of alumina. Okay, let's go to the next question, please. Gneiss is obtained from sedimentary metamorphic rock. Okay, it is combination of two, that is sedimentary metamorphic. Therefore, sedimentation and metamorphism are the reasons for formation of gneiss. Okay, gneiss is a sedimentary metamorphic rock. Then, advantage of a clamp compared to a kiln for burning brick is that it has less initial cost. Okay, clamp requires less initial capital over kiln. Okay, let's go to question number next. The stretcher bond in brick masonry can be used only when the thickness of wall is 90 mm. Okay, when wall thickness is desired to be 90 mm, then we will go with stretcher bond. Clay and silt content in a good brick earth must be at least 50%. Okay, the composition constituent of clay and silt should be 50%. Basalt is a extrusive igneous rock. Means when the molten mass which is present inside earth crust comes out and then cools over the outside atmosphere, okay, over the surface which is exposed to outside atmosphere, then it is called as extrusive igneous rock. Okay, if the molten mass cools inside the surface or below the surface of the earth, then it will be known as intrusive. Okay, but basalt is what? Extrusive igneous rock. Okay, let's see. Hardest and softest rock are respectively diamond and talc. Okay, diamond is the hardest one on Mohr scale and talc is the softest one on Mohr scale. Okay, you can literally scratch the talc by using your fingernails, and in order to scratch or abrase the diamond, you require another diamond. Okay, diamond can only abrase or cause wear and tear of another diamond. Okay, that's why hardest one diamond, softest one is talc. Marble is chemically known as, okay, the chemical name of or chemical classification of the marble is metamorphic rock. Okay, it is a metamorphic rock. It takes place, the formation of marble takes place because of the metamorphism or metamorphic processes that goes in nature. And metamorphism means nothing but action of temperature, that is heat and pressure, for a tremendous or long period over some compound that gets converted into a solid, that is rock. Okay. A good quality stone must, okay, it must be durable, correct? Then it must be free from clay, okay? There should not be any clay impurity present on the surface of the stone or inside the pores of the stone. Then it should resist acid action. That's why the correct answer is all of the above. A good stone should be durable, then it should be free from clay, then it should resist the action of acids. Then argillaceous and calcareous material in cement manufacturing process are burnt at 1450 degrees Celsius. Remember it, 1450 degrees Celsius. Argillaceous means the majority content is clay and calcareous means majority content is calcium. Okay, 1450 degrees Celsius they are burnt at. Then final setting time for ordinary Portland cement should be 600 minutes or 10 hours. Okay, it is 600 minutes or 10 hours. OPC's final setting time, that is OPC's FST is 10 hours or 600 minutes. Then tendency of a rock is to split along its cleavage. Okay, cleavage is the specific portion or specific direction alignment inside a rock where it can be get easily split and we can see the texture, the structure of the rock along that cleavage direction. Okay, next question please. Addition of water to cement causes, yes, heat evolve, correct? It is exothermic reaction, heat gets evolved, then the chemical reaction starts. Yes, the chemical reaction initiates, okay, when you add water to cement, then it forms a paste, correct? Therefore all the three options are right. That's why we are going with all of the above option. Okay, then after cooling, molten magma gets converted into rock. It is known as igneous rock. Okay, we just saw a question regarding this. If the molten magma cools inside the surface, it will be known as intrusive igneous rock, and the molten magma over the surface, which is called as lava, if the lava cools, it is extrusive igneous rock. Okay, cooling of molten material forms a rock which is known as igneous rock. Then to determine soundness of cement, we go with Lee Chatelier's test. Okay, for soundness, remember it is always Lee Chatelier's test. Then chief constituents of Portland cement are lime and silica. Okay, lime and silica are the main component of PC, OPC. Initial setting of cement is caused by C3A or tricalcium aluminate. Okay, tricalcium aluminate, or which is shortened as C3A. Then upon storage, what happens with cement when you are storing it for a long time? It loses strength, obviously. Okay, the strength properties of cement fade away or get diminished when you are storing it for a very long period. Then compressive strength of OPC after 3 days should not be less than 16 MPa. Okay, remember it, compressive strength of OPC, that is ordinary Portland cement, after 3 days, 3 days strength should not be less than 16 MPa, megapascal. Excess lime in Portland cement causes unsoundness. Okay, if the lime's contribution in Portland cement is more than the specified one, then it will cause unsoundness in the cement. Then chemically, quick lime is nothing but calcium oxide, CaO. Okay, calcium oxide, CaO. Underwater construction uses which kind of lime? Obviously, the name is itself suggesting it is hydraulic lime. Hydra, water, and underwater construction is going to utilize hydraulic lime. To obtain hydraulic lime, what we are doing? We burn the clinker. Clinker is burnt in order to obtain hydraulic lime. When added with water, what happens with quick lime? Okay, quick lime's addition with water evolves heat, that is, it generates heat. It is exothermic reaction and it forms slake lime. Therefore, both the options are correct. That's why we will go with option D, which is both A and B. Then hydraulicity is imparted to hydraulic lime by clay. Clay is the prime component which is imparting the hydraulicity property to the lime. Then for hydraulic lime, the initial setting time is 2 hours or let's just say 120 minutes. 120 minutes or 2 hours is the initial setting time, IST, of hydraulic lime. We have to choose the correct statement out of given. Hydraulic lime is used generally in lime mortar. Yes, that is correct. Hydraulic lime is used for underwater application. Yes, the name itself it is suggesting. Yes. Then lime concrete is used for flooring at ground level. Yes, this is also correct. That's why we will go with all of the above. Okay. The correct answer is all of the above, since all the three statements provided in the question are correct. Then for whitewashing, what we are using? We use fat lime. Okay. We go with fat lime when whitewashing purpose is there in building construction. Normal curing period for lime mortar is 7 days. Okay. Normal curing period for lime mortar is 7 days. Annular rings gives the age of the tree. Okay. If you cut the tree, then if you cut the midsection of the tree or any section which is present, okay, for example, let's say this is a tree, and if you cut this specific section, okay, if you cut the tree laterally, then the wood, cut wood will be providing some sort of this imagery. Okay, this each ring is responsible for 1 year growth. Therefore, by just counting the number of rings which are present inside the bark of the tree, you can calculate its age. Okay, it gives the age of the tree. Seasoning of the timber is necessary, okay, in order to remove the moisture or sap. Yes, correct. To minimize shrinkage, splitting of timber. Yes, correct. To increase its strength. Yes, correct. Therefore, all of the above. Okay, seasoning means we just keep the cut wood, okay, the timber exposed to atmosphere or in a specific zone in order to get rid of the moisture which is present inside it when it was in the form of tree. Okay, and when the moisture is getting reduced, the unnecessary components are also getting removed with the moisture escape. Thereby, it increases the strength and reduces, get rid of the problem such as shrinkage or splitting of the timber. Okay, that's why seasoning of timber is necessary. Then, workability of timber refers to, okay, we have seen workability of cement, concrete, but the workability here, it is referring regarding timber, which is proper seasoning of the timber. Okay, then ease in operating the timber for giving it a specific shape, that is sawing and cutting. Then getting a smooth surface after cutting it. Okay, therefore all the things are in reference to workability of the wood of the timber. That's why all of the above is the option we should go with. Then a well seasoned timber has a moisture content up to 10 to 12%. Okay, 10 to 12% is the moisture range in a well-seasoned, properly seasoned timber. Okay, choose the correct option regarding sapwood. It possesses high strength? No. It has closer annular ring? No. It has nothing to do with closer or farther annular ring. Okay, it is weak in strength and easily attacked by insects? Yes. The fresh wood, which is having much moisture in it, which is unseasoned, okay, is weak in strength and can get easily attacked by insects. Okay, due to shrinkage of interior part because of aging of timber, defect caused in timber is heart shakes. Okay, heart shake is the defect which is because of aging of the timber and shrinkage of interior part. Wounds left after branches are cut off in an irregular pattern are known as ringalls. Okay, ringall is the defect in timber when you are cutting the branches in irregular pattern, then the wounds can be seen, which are known as ringalls. Pigment imparts color to the paint. Okay, pigment is the material which imparts the specific desired color to the paint. Okay, remember it, pigment. Then, turpentine is a thinner. okay. Turpentine decreases the consistency of paint, okay. Thinner is the material that decreases the thickness of the paint, okay. It is called as thinner. Following processes are is used for preservation of timber. Painting or spraying, yes, we can do it. Charring, yes, we can do it. Dipping, we can do it. Then all of the above is the answer, okay. We can paint or spray the timber with a specific anti-corrosive kind of paint, okay, anti-moisture or moisture proof kind of paint we can spray the timber with. Then charring means slightly burning the upper surfaces of the timber so that the upper surfaces get converted into carbon, and the carbon thus prevent the timber when it is attacked by insect, okay. Then you can dip the timber or wood in specific chemical, okay, or a specific paint, and that adds to the life of timber, which causes its preservation, obviously. Okay, that's why all of the above options here are correct. Then we are at the paint topic now. Formation of bubbles below paint surface is known as blistering. Okay, blistering means what? For example, if you are seeing the cross section of the paint which is having this blistering problem, then it will be looking something like this. Okay, some sort of air bubbles can be seen, or it can be felt to the touch. Okay, for example, this is the wall, then the specific blistering can be seen, just like some elevated bubbles of air inside it. Okay, blistering is the problem or the defect in paint. Then timber can be made fireproof to some extent by soaking it into ammonium sulfate. Okay, you can soak the whole timber body inside ammonium sulfate, or you can spray the ammonium sulfate solution over the timber so that we can make it fireproof. Okay, remember it, ammonium sulfate. The material which helps the paint to spread over a surface is called as vehicle. Vehicle causes even spreading of the paint over the surface to which the paint is to be applied. Okay, vehicle is the answer. Then for obtaining protective surface, which paint is used? Okay, the answer is bitumen paint. Okay, bitumen paint helps cover or helps protect a specific surface. We apply bitumen paint to it. Then to reduce the cost and weight of a paint, we are using adulterant. Okay, adulterant is the material that we add in order to reduce its cost and to increase its mass and to increase its economy. Okay, to increase its economy. Then red lead is added in paint to obtain corrosive resistance. Okay, if you add red lead to the paint, then its corrosive property are improved. Okay, then to accelerate the rate of drying, we are going to use dryer. Okay, the name itself is suggesting dryer is the thing. Okay, following is a fire resisting paint. Yes, asbestos paint is a fire resisting paint you can have. Maximum permissible differential settlement in case of foundation on sandy soil is limited to 25 mm. Okay, maximum permissible differential settlement we are talking about. In case of foundation on sandy soil is limited to 25 mm. Then pile that support the load by friction as well as by resting on hard stratum is known as friction bearing pile. Okay, it will be making use of both the thing, that the depth at which hard strata is present, it will be lowered to that specific depth. Also, it will be having the rough surface that will be utilizing the friction property present on the surface of the pile so that it can take the load which is over it, which is placed over it. Okay, if the stability is achieved only by friction, then it will be a friction pile. If the stability is only achieved by resting on a bottommost hard available surface, then it will be known as bearing pile. Okay, this is combination of both, that's why it is called as friction bearing pile. Facts associated with black cotton soil is or are: it shrinks when it dries. Yes, when moisture is leaving the black cotton soil, BCS, then it is shrinking. It undergoes tremendous volume changes when you are adding or removing moisture content in it. It swells when it gets wet. Okay, all the three points are pointing toward the volume shrinkage or expansion properties upon addition or removal of moisture from the black cotton soil. That's why we will go with all of the above. All the three points mentioned here are correct. Then, in case of soil having low bearing capacity, foundation provided is, yes, it can be mat footing or rough footing or grillage footing. Okay, we cannot provide isolated kind of foundation over there. That's why we will have to go with a footing or foundation which covers maximum area. That's why all of the above is the answer. Fill in the blank has highest bearing capacity. Clay soil, no. Sandy soil, no. Soft rock, no. Hard rock, yes. Hard rock has the highest bearing capacity amongst the given option. Okay. Then advantages of pre-stressed concrete pilar. It is lightweight. Yes, it is durable. Correct. It is easy to handle. Okay. On-site pouring and all the things are not involved when you are having a pre-stressed concrete pile. Okay. That's why all of the above options provided here are very much true regarding pre-stressed concrete pile. Which of the following pile has a bulb at its bottom? Okay, it is MacArthur pile. Okay, a pile is there and it has an enlarged portion at its bottom. It is the MacArthur pile. Eccentricity of load should not exceed B by 6 for rectangular foundation of width B. Okay, remember it. Eccentricity of load should not exceed how much? B by 6 for rectangular foundation, where B is the width of the foundation. Answer A is the one. Then, generally, stretcher bond is used for half brick wall. Yes, for half brick wall, we will always go with stretcher bond. Bearing capacity of soil can be increased by, yes, we can use pile over there. We can drain, we can remove the subsoil moisture or water, correct? Then, ramming aggregate into the soil, it is going to cause compaction of the surrounding soil when you are ramming aggregate or foreign material into the soil. That's why all of the above should be the option we should go with. Fill in the blank should be used for hardening of thicker walls. Yes, headers shall be used for hardening of thicker walls. Then, to ensure soundproofing, damp proofing and heat insulation, what we are going to use? We are going to use cavity wall, okay, for damp proof course. In damp proof coursing, only damp proofing will be ensured. For having soundproofing, damp proofing and heat insulation, we are going to use cavity wall. Cavity wall is nothing but a small portion which is vacuumized or left unfilled, okay, in between a wall. It is called as cavity wall. Okay, cavity itself, the name is suggesting. Then, expansion joints are provided in masonry wall when wall length exceeds 40 meter. Okay, for example, these two walls are there. Okay, then once the wall's length has gone up to 40 meter, then expansion joint is provided. Then construction of another wall is continued. Okay, it goes on as long as the length of wall is there. Then, slenderness ratio for masonry wall should not be more than 20. Okay, slenderness ratio of masonry wall should not be more than 20. Remember it, 20. Layer of concrete placed on exposed top of external wall is called as coping. Coping is a term associated with the layer of concrete placed on exposed top of external wall. Okay. Then, in the wall face, the 19 by 9 side of brick is known as stretcher. Yes. The 19 by 9 side of the brick is known as stretcher. Okay, the vertical wall face of an opening that supports the frame is called as jamb. Okay, jamb is the vertical wall face of an opening that supports the frame. Okay, door frame. Then, stretcher bond is used in brick masonry when the wall thickness is 90 mm. Okay, we just saw this question, I think. Okay, 90 mm or half brick wall. Okay. Depression or cut provided in the door frame to receive the door shutter is called as rivet. The terms associated in windows and doors we are looking at right now. Okay, the depression or cut or groove provided in the door frame to receive the door when it gets flush in the frame, the term it is rivet. Then fill in the blank in the vertical outside member of shutter of door or window style. Okay, vertical outside member of shutter of door or window is called as style. Then places that have air conditioning and continuous visitor adopt revolving door. Okay, let's see the top view how it is there. For example, this is the opening provided in the building. Then a revolving door is there which has four panels like this. Okay, and it goes on revolving and it does not let the outside air come in and it does not let the inside air go out. That is, air conditioning can take place effectively and the entry or exit of visitor doesn't get compromised over there. Then gable window is provided on sloping roof on a building to provide ventilation, light and improve appearance. Okay, gable window is the name. Remember, gable. Okay, on a sloping roof it is provided like this or like this only. Okay, then places where additional light in the room and visibility from outside of the room is required use glaze or sash door. Okay, it is kind of transparent that has glass panel. It is called as glaze or sash door. Then to subdivide a window or a door vertically, this vertical member is used is called as mullion. Mullion or mullion is the member that divides the window or door vertically. Okay, this one says what? Mullion. External jamb of a door or a window opening at right angles to the wall face is called as reveal. It is called as reveal. Reveal is the term for that specific component. Horizontal and vertical portion of a step are respectively called as tread and riser. For example, this is the step we are talking about. This is what? Riser, and this is what? Tread. Lowermost horizontal part of a window frame is called as sill. Okay, the lowermost portion or part of a window frame is called as sill. Then a leveled platform at the top or bottom of flight between the floor to facilitate change of direction is called as landing. Okay, for example, let's say this is a dogleg stair, then this specific portion is one landing and this specific portion is one landing where we have turned in 180 degree manner. Okay, it is called as landing. Projected portion of the tread beyond riser face is called as nosing. Okay, let's say these are the staircase we are having. Okay, then this specific raised portion, okay, projected portion, it is called as what? Nosing. Okay, this is nosing. Then location where space is limited and to provide emergency exit stairway for a building, we go with circular staircase. Okay, circular staircase requires the minimum space and it can act as emergency exit stairway. See, circular staircase cannot act as the main access stairway. Okay, it is the kind of secondary or emergency exit stairway. Then handrail provides assistance for using stairway or staircase. Okay, handrail means, for example, this is the staircase, then these are the handrails that we use to put our hand, or they act as guide for accessing or for using the stairway. Then vertical member made up of wood or metal supporting the handrail is called as baluster. Okay, baluster are the supporting column like structure. Okay, for example, these are the staircase we are talking about and this is the rail we are talking about. Then these member, these vertical member which can be made up of wood or metal, are called as baluster. Generally, pitch of the stair is kept between 25 to 40 degree. Okay, this is the most comfortable range of pitch. Or pitch means what? For example, you are having this staircase, then if you connect a line like this, okay, then this specific inclination, let's say theta, then the most comfortable angle to ascend and to descend the staircase is in between the range 25 degree to 40 degree. If you decrease the pitch below 25 degree, it is going to make the staircase too long or too gentle sloping. Okay, if you exceed the pitch beyond 40 degree, then it kind of feels intimidating when you are accessing the staircase. Then for comfortable ascent and descent, product of rise and going should be in the range of 400 to 450. Okay, the dimension of tread and rise should be in the range of 400 to 450. Then normally adopted width of staircase for residential building is 90 centimeter. For example, this is the staircase stairway you are seeing. Then the comfortable range or accessible range for having width of the staircase is 90 centimeter, just less than 1 meter. Then bearing of the lintel should be height of the lintel, okay, 1/10 to 1/12 of span of lintel, okay, 10 centimeter. It should be minimum of these three, okay. Whichever is minimum of all these three dimensions should be adopted as the bearing of the lintel. Then arcade is a row of arches in continuation. Okay, for example, this is the continuation of arches. Okay, this is arch number 1, 2, 3, 4. Then this specific range of arches is called as what? Arcade. Arches are constructed where loads are heavy, yes, span is more, yes, then strong abutment is available, that is supports for placing the arches is available. Therefore, all of these is the option we should go with. Okay, inner and outer curves of an arch are called as intrados and extrados respectively. Okay, remember the terms intrados and extrados. For example, this is the arch we are having, then this is what, the specific curvature is what, intrados. Okay, this outside curvature is what, extrados. Okay, wedge shape units of masonry that form an arch is called as voussoirs. Okay, voussoirs. Okay, voussoirs or voussoirs. Okay, for example, these are the units that are forming the specific arch over here, like this. Okay, the circular, the arc like structure that takes place after joining these wedges are called as voussoirs. Then an arch may fail because of crushing of the masonry. Okay, if the independent component is getting crushed somewhere, then the arch is going to fail. Then sliding of the voussoir, yes, if one of the or more adjacent voussoir are getting differential sliding, it is going to fail. Then uneven settlement of the pier. Okay, the pier, the column, the support over which the arch is kept, if it is having uneven settlement, then the arch may fail. That's why we will go with any of A and B and C. Then highest part of the extrados is known as crown. Okay, for example, this is the arch we are talking about. Then the highermost apex or the topmost part is called as crown. Okay, remember it, crown. Then brick lintel can be used when loads are light and opening is less than 1 meter. Okay, if the loads are light and opening is less than 1 meter, we can go with brick lintel. To ensure stability of the arch, abutment should be strong. Yes, the supports, the pier should be very much strong. Symmetry of the arch should be maintained. Yes, it should not be like this, the half curve is like this and the other half is like this. Symmetry should be there. Okay, symmetry like this should be there. Then voussoir of more height should be provided. Yes, voussoir, the independent masonry units which are provided for construction of arch should be of more height. Therefore, the correct option we will go with is all of the above. Then for heavy engineering work, so that, let's say, foundation of dam is there, okay, then foundation of bridge is there, pier is there, abutment is there, we will go with igneous rock, since their specific gravity and strength property, structure property amongst the given one are very good. Sedimentary rock don't have that much strength as compared to igneous rock. Metamorphic rock are not that good in case of strength, texture, structure, okay, then durability. Igneous rocks are the one which are very much load taking and which are very much good in durability. Then in stone masonry joints, when dress edges of two adjacent stores are placed side to side in the joint is called as butt joint. Okay, let's say these two stones are kept just adjacent to each other, this joint will be known as butt joint. In lifting stone, which of the tool or tools are used? Okay, chain levers we can use, then chain dog we can use, the nippers we can use. Therefore, all of these tools can be used for lifting the stone while constructing a stone masonry. Okay, that's why all of the above is the option. For fire resistant masonry, we can go with compact sand. Okay, compact sandstone is the stone for having a fire resistant stone masonry. Roughly dressed or undressed blocks of stone are used in rubble masonry. Remember it? Rubble masonry, in which we use roughly dressed or undressed blocks of stone. Tools used to split the stone is called as gad. Gad is the one tool which is used for splitting the stone for getting the desired shape over there. Then ashlar rough tool masonry is also known as bastard ashlar. Okay, ashlar rough tool masonry is aka bastard ashlar. Then finest type of stone masonry work is done in ashlar masonry. Okay, in ashlar masonry we are going to have the finest type of stone that are used for making up that masonry. Then pitch roofs are suitable in high rainfall region. Okay, pitch roof means having slope. Okay, slope is provided only to get rid of the snow or rainfall or precipitation. Okay, then in this typical pitch roof, slope on only one side is provided. In this type of pitch roof, slope on only one side is provided. Okay, lean to roof. Okay, lean to roof is the one in which house structure is something like this. This is the total slope provided along only one side. Okay, otherwise slopes can be provided in two or in this direction also. Okay, in lean to roof we are providing slope on only one side. Then roughest and cheapest form of stone masonry is random rubble. You can have any kind of stone, any kind of position or placement of the stone when you are talking about random rubble masonry. Then flat roofs are suitable in, yes, hot regions, low rainfall region, means there is no need to get frequent rid of precipitation which is likely to get stored on the roof surface. Therefore low rainfall region flat roof is suitable. Then no snowfall region, obviously if there is no snowfall there is no accumulation of the snow precipitation over the roof. That's why all of the above is the answer we should go with. Then ridge formed by the intersection of two sloping surfaces when exterior angle is greater than 180 degree is called as hip. Okay, that specific ridge is called as hip. Then four sloping surfaces in four direction makes a hip roof. Okay, for example, we are viewing in top view, let's say, then this is the generalized or most simplistic diagram of a hip roof. Okay, slope is provided in this direction also, along this direction also, along this one and along this one also. Okay, in frontal view it is going to look something like this. Okay, this is the only roof we can see in this front diagram. Then in pitch roof, the vertical distance between top of the ridge and the wall plate is called as rise. Okay, the term is rise. The vertical distance between top of the ridge and the wall plate is called as rise. Then purlins are used to support. Okay, in roof we are using the purlin to support the common rafter.